Thank you, Jeannie, and thank you everyone for being here today. And yeah, today I'm gonna tell you all a little bit about how worms coordinate their behavior. And just as a visual description, I'm a Latin woman. I have long brown wavy hair and I wear glasses and I'm wearing a black shirt with some flowers on it. And I'm sitting in a lab environment and I have some computers and some screwdrivers and other things like that behind me. And I'm originally from Brazil, not from the coast or from the shore, as everyone usually thinks about Brazil, but I'm from the mountain regions, from a city called Belo Horizonte, and you can see a picture of it here with this very pretty mountain range in the background. And that's where I grew up, and that's where I went to college, where I studied biology. And I moved to New York City in 2018 to do my PhD degree in neuroscience. And when I'm not in the lab studying how animals behave, usually what I'll do is take trips with my friends, like you can see in this picture of all of us in a lake upstate standing in front of a fire pit. I also like to do watercolors, as you can see, this is a picture of a orchid watercolor I did recently. And I'll also spend my time hanging out with my partner, like going to cafes, for example, to eat matcha donuts, like you can see here, and also playing with our two tuxedo cats that are here in this picture in playing in their favorite place, which is the cat tower. And in the lab, what I study is how fruit flies, which I think Chad has talked about in a previous session, how fruit flies can remember places in space where they got something or something really good happened to them. And so what I'll do is that I'll give flies a very good stimulus, like a drop full of sugar, for example. And then I'll look at how they behave and if they can remember that place by coming back to it after they've already consumed the sugar drop. And I'll also look at their brain while they do this. And what I'm trying to figure out is how cells in their brain are remembering this location. But so, today, what I want to talk to you guys about is about group behaviors. And in previous sessions, Chad, Taylor, and Lindsay have talked about group behaviors that animals can do when they're somehow talking and coordinating with each other. And that can be either through chemical communication, like the ants using some kind of pheromone to coordinate group rating, for example, or it can be done through visual cues by flies looking at another fly doing something and learning something from that, or it can be done by mechanical stimuli or other things. But today what I want to talk to you about is behaviors that look highly coordinated and like all the animals are doing the same thing or coordinating with each other something, but that don't necessarily require each individual to be talking with each other and communicating to do that. And so maybe one classic example of this that most people have seen is bird murmurations. And so when we look at the sky and we see birds flying together in these very coordinated patterns, we can think that like, okay, this is like this like very complex collective behavior. But what most scientists think is happening here is not that the birds are actually like communicating with each other every moment to try to plan out what they're gonna do next, but actually that they're probably just following a couple very simple rules. Like for example, just try to stay close to the bird next to you, but don't bump into it. And that just by following these kinds of rules, you can get this very complex behavior. And there's examples of this in humans as well. And one example that I really like about to bring up is marathons. And so if we look at the New York City Marathon, for example, if we just look at sort of a bird's eye view of the marathon, it also looks like this really coordinated, complex behavior where all the humans are kind of moving together pretty much at the same time. But if we just like go into the marathon and like look at each individual runner, it's not like they're at all times talking to the person next to them, trying to figure out like where to go next and how fast to go. They're also just like, you know, following the marathon path and just trying to like stay at a constant speed and not, you know, bump into anyone. And just like by following those few simple rules, we can get this pretty complicated behavior. And so this is the kind of behavior that collective behavior that I want to talk about today. But I'm not going to talk about it in either birds or humans, but in this very simple organism that are these ground worms called Canohabidis elegans, which are commonly referred to as C. elegans, and that's what I'm going to call them from now on. And so C. elegans are these small ground worms that live in patches of bacteria in either rotten fruit or in rotting roots of plants. And they're very tiny, they're about 1 millimeter long. And they're very commonly studied in biology and in neuroscience. And a couple of reasons why we often use these organisms is that, first of all, they're very easy to manipulate genetically. So it's very easy to make mutants with them. And I'm gonna talk more about that later on in the talk. They also have a very simple nervous system. They only have 302 neurons. And we know what each and every one of those cells are. And not just that, but we have what's called the complete connectome of this animal. And what that means is that we also know how each neuron is connected to each other. So we know for each neuron, which other neurons it talks to. And so we basically have a whole map of this animal's brain. And what this does is that it makes it much easier for us to figure out how specific neurons are controlling this worm's behavior. And so this is why people study C. elegans a lot in the lab. And just as a kind of a question for you guys to think about, I was wondering if you have a guess as to what animal C. elegans might be more closely evolutionary related to. So we have earthworms, ants, and humans. And if you guys want to go ahead and guess. I think, have most people voted? Okay, yeah. So I think everyone voted and the overwhelming result is earthworms. And that's usually what most people will think. But actually one curiosity is that, let me just put this away. So one interesting fact is that it's actually not earthworms. The answer is ants. So actually, both arthropods, which are a group that include all insects, and so ants, and nematodes, which is the group that includes C. elegans and other worms like it, are included in this greater group that's called ecdysozoa. And what ecdysozoa is just all animals that molt. And so what this means is that all of these animals shed their kind of skin to be able to grow. And so this is what you can see here. This is a worm that's kind of shedding its old skin here and coming out as a bigger animal with a new skin. And here we can also see this in these ants, that's like shedding its like old skin here and coming out as like a bigger ant. And so these two groups are actually very closely related to each other, much more than earthworms, for example, that are in this other group over here that's more closely related to animals like sea slugs, for example. And humans are all the way over here, and we're actually more closely related to starfish and sea cucumbers than any of these other groups. And so for today, what the behavior of C. elegans that we're gonna be looking at is this kind of collective swarming behavior that these animals have while they feed in bacteria. And so when biologists started studying these worms, they brought them to the lab. And in the lab, how we study them is that we put them in these petri dishes that are covered in agarose, which is just this kind of soft substance that the worms can wiggle around in. And we cover this agarose in bacteria that the worms can feed on. And what people notice is that when you just put worms in this environment in the lab, often you'll notice them doing this collective feeding behavior that they called swarming. And that's what I'm gonna share in this video over here. And just to orient you before I show it, what we're gonna look at is in black here, you can see the worms. These here, like you have some individual worms, and also we have these big blobs where all the worms are together. And behind the background is just the agarose, which in that the petri dish is covered in. And in part, this like rugged part of the agarose, what that is the bacteria. So all the part that has this, all the background that has this kind of rugged appearance to it is covered in bacteria. And all the background that has this more smoother appearance to it doesn't have any bacteria anymore. And that's because the worms ate it. And so when we look at these worms and these petri dishes in the lab, often what we'll notice is them doing this behavior over here that we can see. So we can see that they form these blobs and then they kind of move together towards where there's still food in the petri dish. And they really just clean off the petri dish and very efficiently like eat everything that's left. And what made people particularly interested in this behavior is that these worms can do this pretty coordinated collective behavior in spite of the fact that they actually move in the really simple patterns. And so when we just look at a single worm moving, it basically just moves in two very simple ways. One is the forward movements, which is just if we look at just a worm and this being the worm's head and this being its tail, what a forward movement is just the worm wiggling in the direction of its head. And that's what we can see here in this video. We have a worm moving here. This is its head and it's just kind of wiggling in this direction. And the other kind of movement that these worms are capable of is what we call reversals. And that is when the worm wiggles, but in the direction of its tail. And so this is what we can see here in this video, in this little moment when the worm kind of backs up. We can look at it again. Here's the head, here's the tail, and she kind of like does this little reversal. And so we really just, we have these very simple movement patterns that these individuals can do, but somehow they can like use these very simple movement patterns to generate this very complicated or very coordinated collective behavior. And so this is kind of what the scientists in this paper were interested in asking, how do you go from these simple movements to this complicated collective behavior? And so the name of the paper that we're gonna look at is Shared Behavioral Mechanisms, Underlie C. elegans Aggregation and Swarming. It was published in this journal called Elife, which is a pretty cool journal because all of the papers that are published here are open access. And what that means is that they're free for everyone to read. So you can just go on their website and read any of the papers that are there. You don't have to pay anything for it. And you can even see what the scientists that reviewed the paper said about it. So it's a pretty nice journal. And this is the name of the authors that did this experiment. And they were all working in different parts of the United Kingdom at the time. But one cool thing is that Serena Ding, which is the first author, so she's the scientist that really led this study, is actually now in Germany, and she opened up her own lab that's entirely dedicated to studying these kinds of collective behaviors in C. elegans. So she's really interested in this. And this paper that we're gonna look at is maybe a little different from papers that we've seen in the past few sessions because it's a hypothetical modeling paper. And what that means is that it's a paper where scientists make some kind of hypothetical representation of the process that they're trying to study. And so to try to make that a little bit less abstract, in the case of a hypothetical modeling paper of behavior, for example, what that means is that scientists will go and collect data on how the specific animal that they're interested in behaves. They'll come up with a couple rules that they think that these animals are using to generate this behavior. And then what they'll do is that they'll make a computer model using these rules. And what that means in this paper, for example, is that they'll just make a virtual worm that just moves following the rules that were given by the scientists to the computer. And then they'll just look at how this worm behaves and compare it to how real worms behave and try to see if they have the right rules that the worms are following. And so to do this, the researchers used two strains of worms, one which they're going to call N2, which are worms that almost never do any swarming behavior, and another one that's called NPR1, which are worms that do a lot of swarming behavior. And what a strain is kind of a sub-classification inside of species. So it's kind of subgroups inside of species that are different enough that we put them separately, but they're similar enough to each other that we still call it the same species. And to give you maybe a more clear example of that, we can think of dogs. So dogs is just like a single species, and everything that we call a dog is inside that species. But inside of that, we actually have a lot of variation, right? So we can inside of the species dog, we can have something that's like a Chihuahua, for example, and something that's the Doberman. And so what that would be different strains. So like everything that looks like a Chihuahua, we classify in the strain Chihuahua, and everything that looks like a Doberman, we'd classify in the strain Doberman. And they're still similar enough that we call everything dogs, but inside of that, we have these subgroups. And it's the same thing here. So we have this one subgroup that we're gonna call N2 that almost never does any swarming behavior. And this group is just like worms that were found in a city in the United Kingdom called Bristol. And when people put them in the lab, they just realized that they don't really do this collective feeding. And they became a very common kind of worm to use in the lab, actually, because when you're not trying to study swarming, it's kind of annoying to have your worms doing it all the time. So a lot of worm labs use this strain for this specific purpose. And then NPR1 is actually not a strain that's naturally found in the environment. What it is a mutant strain. And so what that means is that people actually took this original N2 strain that was found in the environment and they exposed it to a mutagen agent. And what that is just a chemical that causes the DNA of these worms to have a bunch of changes. And one of these changes caused the worms to actually do a lot of swarming behavior. And what people figured out is that the original N2 strain actually has a gene that doesn't work. And the mutation that makes NPR1 worms swarm a lot actually makes that gene work again. And so it seems like this one specific gene is really important for this behavior and is what is controlling it. And one kind of curious fact is that people do know that this gene is expressed in neurons and that it is important for this behavior, but they're still not entirely sure why and like what it's doing to make one worm not do any swarming and the other group of worms do a lot of swarming. But so now that they have these two strains, one N2 that almost never does any swarming, and another one, NPR1, that does a lot of swarming, they can then go and collect data on how these two different strains of worms behave and then try to figure out what's controlling this behavior. And so to do this, the scientists just put these worms in petri dishes covered in agarose and in bacteria and just film them from above to see how these different animals behaved. And what these recordings look like is actually the video that I showed you in the beginning. So that video was from this specific paper. And it was a video of the NPR1 strain. And just to remind you of what we're going to be looking at, in black we have the worms. The background that's rugged is where the bacteria that the worms are feeding on is. And the kind of smooth background is where there's not any bacteria left because the worms have eaten it. And so what the behavior looks like is that the worms just gather around in these blobs, and there's like worms coming in and out of the blobs, but overall they stay in these blobs and the blobs move towards the direction in which there's still food, and they just kind of consume really efficiently all the food in this petri dish. And so to look at this behavior a little bit closely, what we can do is that we can just take like photos of what the worms are doing at different points in the experiment. And so first we can look at NPR1 worms, which are the worms that do a lot of swarming. And we can look at a photo of what these worms were doing 30 minutes after the scientists put them in the petri dish. And what we can see is that these worms were already kind of like congregated together in this little clump. And here we can see maybe a couple individual worms that aren't in this clump, but most of them have already gathered together. And as time goes on in the experiment, we can see that some worms come in and out of the clump, but most worms are still in the clump and the clump is moving. So it's like at 60 minutes, it's here, at 90 minutes, it's here, at 2 hours, it's over here. And at 2.5 hours, we see that this clump of worms has made its way all the way across the petri dish. And we can look at that over time, where here we can see just kind of these photos all overlaid on top of each other. And in purple, we can see where the worms were in the beginning of the experiment. And we can see that throughout the experiment, they kind of move all over the petri dish and they end up in this yellow region. And you can see that they really kind of efficiently moved over the entire petri dish, kind of consuming all the food that was there in 2.5 hours. And here, if we look at the N2 strain that doesn't really do any swarming, we can see that that doesn't happen and that the worms are just kind of moving around in the petri dish, but they're not really gathering into a clump or anything, and they're not really moving together over the petri dish to sort of like clean, polish off all the food in it. And one kind of cool thing that you can notice is that there's actually the same number of worms in both of these conditions, but there actually looks like there's less worms in the NPR1 case. And that's just because they're so piled on top of each other that you can't really see all of them. And so now that we have a general idea of what this behavior looks like, we can start to try to come up with the rules that the individuals are using to generate this group behavior. And to do that, what we really want to do is look at what each single worm is doing while they're doing this collective feeding. And it's kind of hard to do that in the first videos that I showed you because the worms are so piled on top of each other that you can't really tell one from the other. And so a trick that the researchers used in this paper was to make a specific part of the mouth of these worms that's called the pharynx glow in the dark. And they did that by creating a mutant in a very similar way to what I described in the beginning. And so here we can see when there's light on, just like the individual worms, and they just look like normal worms. But when we turn the light off and we shine a very specific kind of light on these worms, we can see that their mouth parts start glowing. And so now if we look at them, at the worms in the dark, we can see that each individual worm is fluorescing like a little blob. And now we can track them even when they're kind of on top of each other. And then we can ask what each single worm is doing while they're doing this collective feeding behavior. And the scientists are going to ask this in terms of those two specific kinds of movements that I talked to you about in the beginning. So forward movements, which are when worms wiggle in the direction of their head, and reversals, which are when worms wiggle away from their heads in the direction of their tail. And we're gonna, and the first thing that they looked at was reversals. And so what they did is that they asked how often do worms reverse when there's different numbers of worms around. And so, and that's what we're looking at in this figure here. And so here in the x-axis, what we have is just that they're asking how many, for each worm at each moment in the video, how many other worms are kind of close by. And this just kind of goes from like not really any worms close by to a lot of worms close by. And then in the y-axis, what we have is how often are the worms reversing? And what this is just like how many times do they reverse divided by just how long are they moving forward. And so in orange, we have what the N2 worms are doing, which are the worms that don't really do any reversals, don't really do the swarming behavior. And in blue, we have what the NPR1 worms are doing, which are the worms that do the swarming behavior. And what we can see is that when a single worm of either of these strains is surrounded by a lot of other worms, they just do a lot of reversals. And that's true in both cases. What's different is that when there's kind of a couple worms around, but not that many worms, the NPR1 strain, which is the strain that does the swarming behavior, seems to do a lot more reversals than the N2 strain, which is the strain that doesn't really do the swarming behavior. And so to kind of summarize that, the first thing that they found is that the N2 strain, which is the strain that almost never does any swarming, when a single individual is surrounded by a lot of other worms, it goes back and forth a lot. But when it's not really surrounded by that many other worms, it mostly just moves forward. So it just wiggles in the direction of its head. But for the NPR1 strain, which is the strain that does do a lot of swarming, what we see is that when a single worm is surrounded by a lot of other worms, it does a lot of reversal. So it goes back and forth a lot. But even when it's not surrounded by that many other worms, it already starts doing this behavior of going back and forth a lot. And it really only moves forward when it's not surrounded by a lot of worms or not surrounded by any other worms. And so this is kind of the first difference that they notice between these two genotypes. And so the next thing that they asked was if there was any difference between these two strains in forward movement. So the movements that the, so the being when the worm is wiggly in the direction of its head. And they specifically wanted to know if the speed at which these animals do this behavior changes between the two strains, one that does swarming and one that doesn't do swarming. And so the way that they looked at this was just by asking how common is each speed of the worm for each of the densities. And so that's what we're going to look at here. So first, we're going to just look at what the N2 strain, which is the strain that doesn't really do any a lot of swarming, is doing. And here we just have all of the different speeds that the worm can move at. And here we're just asking how frequently is the worm moving at any of these speeds. And we're doing that for each of the densities. So we can start off by just looking at the pink line, which is just how quickly the worms are moving when there aren't really any other worms around. And so that's this pink line here. And what we can see is that in this case, the most common speed of these worms is about 30 micrometers per second. And then we can ask, okay, so, and what about when there's a lot of other worms around a single worm? How fast is that worm moving? And that's what this bright blue line is. And we can see that it over here, and we can see that also for the bright blue condition, when there's just a lot of other worms around, the worms are pretty much moving at the same speed, which is about 30 micrometers a second. And just to make this speed maybe a little bit less abstract, what we can take, we can, if we just look at a single worm, a worm is about 1,000 micrometers long, and that's a millimeter. And so when we say that these worms are moving at about 30 micrometers a second, what that really means is that they're advancing about 3% of their body forward every second. And that's pretty slow. Worms do move pretty slowly. And that's just the normal speed of a worm. So in this condition, in this strain that doesn't really do any swarming, it seems like the worms just move about 3% of their body forward. And this doesn't really seem to be affected by how many other worms are around. So now we can ask what this looks like for the strain that does do the swarming, the NPR1. And so this is what we're looking at over here. And so again, we can we have all of the speeds that the worm can move at and how common they are on the y-axis. And we can start by looking at the condition where there aren't really any other worms around a single worm. And so that's this pink line here. And what we can see is that for NPR1 worms, when there aren't really any other worms around, they actually move pretty quickly for a worm, that is. So they're going at about 250 micrometers a second. And so that's like moving forward about 20% of their body every second. And that's pretty fast for a worm. And what's interesting is that when we ask, okay, so these worms are moving pretty quickly when there's not a lot of worms around. So what are they doing when there's a lot of worms around? And that's what we're seeing here in this bright blue line. And what we can see is that when there are a lot of other worms around, these worms slow down and they start moving at about 30 micrometers a second. So about 3% of their body forward every second. And that's very similar to what the two worms, which are the worms that don't do the swarming, move at. And so just to summarize this, what seems to be going on is that the N2 worms that don't really do the swarming behavior don't seem to really change the speed at which they move forward in the as a function of how many other worms there are around. But in the NPR1 case, that are the worms that do the swarming, they seem to actually move really quickly when there's not a lot of other worms around, and they slow down when there's a lot of other worms around. And so to summarize, the main differences that the scientists, oh, I'm sorry. Just to summarize, the main differences that the scientists found in how the strain that does a lot of swarming, NPR1, versus the strain that doesn't do a lot of swarming, N2, behave, is that NPR1 seems to increase the number of times it reverses, so the number of times it goes back and forth when there's a lot of other worms around, and it seems to slow down when there's a lot of other worms around. And so one way to think about this is that this might be the rules of swarming behavior, the rules that the individuals are following to generate that kind of collective swarming that we saw. So just, you know, if there's a lot of other worms around, just increase the amount of times you go back and forth and slow down a lot, and you can get that kind of behavior. So now that they, the scientists had these two simple rules that they thought might explain the swarming, what they next did was create a computer model that just, it means like making a bunch of little virtual worms that behave following these two simple rules. So slow down and increase the number of reversals when there's other worms around. And they just looked at how these worms behaved when they're in kind of a virtual petri dish. And they're just gonna compare that to how real worms that do swarming behave in the real petri dish and see if it looks alike. And so this is what we're looking at here. So here in this figure, we can see these little blue lines, and those are all the virtual worms that are behaving according to these rules. And they're moving around in this white background, which is just this virtual petri dish. And what we can, and here next to it, we just have the real worms that do the swarming, the NPR1. And what we can see is that these virtual worms, they do kind of gather together and maybe even clump up a little bit, but it maybe it's not as like densely packed as the real behavior where we see these black worms just really like piled on top of each other. And so the researchers were like, okay, it looks a little bit like it, but it's not amazing. So what they did, which is one thing that is common to do in these kinds of papers, is that they went back to their model and they added more rules to see if, so what they thought is like, okay, maybe we don't have all the rules that are guiding swarming behavior. So maybe we should put one more rule and maybe that will make the virtual worms look more like the real worms. And so the rule that they added is that worms not only slow down and increase reversals when there's other worms around, but they're also attracted to other worms. And so what this rule means is just that if for any of these virtual worms, if there's another worm close by, just move in that direction and try to be close to that worm. And so what we're going to see here in this video is the virtual worms that are following these three rules now. And so we can see them kind of wiggling around in this virtual petri dish, and we see that when they find each other, they really slow down and start going back and forth and are kind of piled on top of each other and really want to be clumped together. And so this looks much more like the real behavior. But one thing that we can notice is that while they are like clumped together, they once they find each other, they just kind of stop. And that's not what happens in the real behavior. If we look at the real behavior, the worms are not only clumped together, but they're also moving, and they're moving in the direction in which there's still food. And that's what really makes them kind of move together and clean off the petri dish of all the bacteria that's there. And so the scientists were like, okay, I think we have some of the rules, but we're probably still missing something. And so what they did is that they added one more rule to this model. And this rule was that the worms are now going to also move when there's no longer any food in the part of the petri dish that they're in. And so what this means is that they are now going to make their virtual petri dish kind of deplete of food if worms are on top of that part for some amount of time. And we're gonna see this in this video as just the background turning black. So when the background turns black, it just means that there is no longer any food in this virtual petri dish. And then the rule that the worms are gonna follow is if you're in a black part of the petri dish, you wanna move towards a white part of the petri dish in which there's still food left. And so now we're gonna watch worms that are following these four rules, which is increase the number of reversals when there's other worms around, slow down when there's other worms around, move in the direction of other worms. And also if you're in a part of a petri dish that no longer has any food, so that's black, you wanna move towards a part of the petri dish that's white because it still has food. And that's what we can see in this video here. So we can see the worms slowing down, and we can see that as they spend more and more time in a specific part of this virtual petri dish, it starts turning black. And so that means that the petri dish is getting depleted of food. And we're going to see that as that happens, the worms kind of start moving off of that location that's black towards parts of the petri dish that still have food left. And hopefully what you can notice is that they're kind of doing that still in clumps. And that actually looks quite similar to the real behavior. So the worms are not only gathering in these clumps, but they're also kind of, the clump is moving towards the parts of this virtual petri dish that still have food left over in it. And so this actually looks pretty similar to the real behavior. And so what the researchers in this paper proposed is that the rules that each individual worm is following to generate this coordinated swarming behavior of feeding in bacteria are these four rules. So increasing reversals when there's a lot of other worms around, decreasing speed when there's a lot of other worms around, trying to stay close to other worms, and also if you're in a part of a petri dish that doesn't have any bacteria left because you ate all of it, then move in the direction of a part where there's still bacteria. And that just these four simple rules are enough to explain this kind of coordinated behavior that we saw in the beginning when the worms are all feeding together and really like wiping off all of the bacteria left in the petri dish. And some things to think about this paper are, okay, so we got, you know, this kind of virtual worms to behave pretty similarly to what the real worms behave when they're doing the swarming in the real world. But does that really mean that these are the only rules that matter? Like, could we have just given a different set of rules and gotten the same behavior? And more than that, like, now that we use this model to, you know, kind of come up with some rules that we think are important to guide this behavior, can we then now go back to the real world and take advantage of how easy it is to make mutants in C. elegans and how much we know about the cells that govern these worms' behaviors to try to test some of this? So for example, what if we now make N2 worms, which are worms that don't really do swarming, that do a lot of reversals? Could we get those worms to do something that looks like swarming, or like, you know, so could we change like things in their behavior to test whether or not these are the important rules that they're following to generate the swarming? And another question to just think about is like, why are the worms even doing this in the first place? What is the advantage of this kind of swarming behavior? And one thing that people often bring up is that maybe it's just a really efficient way to eat when there's not a lot of food left in the environment. So you just all get together and kind of move around and clear all the bacteria that's left. And maybe each individual worm is not going to be able to eat that much bacteria, but as a group, they're going to be able to kind of like feed very efficiently in an environment that's maybe kind of depleted of food. But you know, there might be a lot of other explanations, and people don't really know yet why they're doing this kind of swarming.